Check. Welcome everybody to another session, another hashtag Ask Jochen. I'm just going to double check that we are in fact, it takes a couple seconds. There we go. Welcome everyone to another session, another hashtag Ask Jochen live Q&A. Welcome. And please feel free to, as usual, drop a comment and let us know where you are tuning in from. And of course, if you have any questions, any saddle-fitting questions, feel free to leave them in the chat box, whether it be on Facebook or YouTube. And yes, we are in fact live on YouTube. Let me just double check on Facebook. And please feel free to let us know where you're tuning in from. Yep. Welcome everybody. Hi. Seeing your comments now. And okay, awesome. So for those of you who are new to this, so we do a live stream every week with our founder and master saddler, Jochen Schlese. And this is just a little bit of information, a little bit of background about him for those of you who are new. And if you are new and you do have some questions, feel free to drop them in the comment box and we'll get to as many as we can. And now I think we're ready to move on to our intro sequence and then welcome Jochen into today's session.
Hello, hello. How are you, Mary Claire, today?
I'm great. How are you? Welcome. Welcome back to another session.
So when you lived in Ireland, was it that cold too? Like we have it minus 14 or so.
No, I mean, it's definitely not as cold as here. I mean, it did snow the one time that I was over there and everyone was freaking out because it never snows over there. So they were blaming me. They said the Canadian brought all the snow. So,
yeah.
But it's very rare. Yeah. It's very rare compared to here.
So here we are, another week goes by and we have one of our lovely sessions and hopefully we get a lot of answers for those many questions we have today.
Yeah, we always have a truckload of questions that, you know, kind of get left over from the week before because it's kind of hard to get to all of them. Mm-hmm. And then we also take a lot of questions live as well. So we've definitely have a lot on our plate.
100%. I had a lovely session with
YouTube channel. I mean,
she is just a lovely person, huh?
Yeah, she's fantastic.
How rare do we find trainers who are that involved in proper fitting saddles and care so much for the horses? I follow her a lot. I love what she does. And I really enjoy, just like I enjoy with you, these live streams. Really enjoy these live streams with her because she has such a good comparison. And what did she say? Ferrari or something like that? Right?
Yeah, she said she compared... because you're talking about the racing saddles and she compared like what the Schlese racing saddle will be like compared to what the, you know, this racing saddles are like now. And she compared it to, it would be like getting into a Ferrari and driving a Ferrari when you had driven like an old 1980s car or something that's breaking down. Yeah. And I was just, oh my gosh, that's such a great analogy. She's so full of stuff like that and she's a really great great influencer to know.
Yeah, no, sure. I love her. She's amazing. She's a pretty daredevil. She rides so many young horses and I love her. So anyhow, let's carry on today. Give me a challenge. I need a challenge.
10 minutes?
10 minutes. Okay.
Ten minutes of an intro.
All right. That's I'm gonna beat that baby.
All right. It's 5:00, let's say 5:05 right now.
Okay.
Okay, sounds good.
So, everybody, welcome back for all of you guys who tune in every week. And hello to you newcomers who have not seen this weekly challenge. People ask me all the time, why do I do what I do? Very simple. I love riding and I grew up on horse's back. And this horse have given me his soul, his body, his 110% trust. This jump, I'm jumping right here, is 6'4" down. And unfortunately, I overjumped that fence. I came too fast on that. It was our first four-star three-day eventing, our first German three-day eventing championship. And this horse, all of you guys who are horseback riders know what I'm talking about. Once you have that bound between horse and yourself, it's huge. It's amazing. And when he started to show a little bit signs, and I noticed this in his demeanor, and I saw the light getting darker and darker in his eyes. He always gave himself 110%, but all of a sudden he wasn't himself anymore. And it started one day that my coach says, you know, something is not quite right. Let's trot him up. And then we had veterinarians look at it. And, back then there was not, we're talking about the early 80s here. A lot of massage and physiotherapists and chiropractor for horses didn't exist at that stage. And if so, very, very rare. So once we just trot him up and down on asphalt, you didn't really see anything. Just in a dressage saddle. And I had many saddles, was sponsored in different saddles. And I also made a saddle for myself. But the very clear sign was that the horse started to show lamenesses. Now today we have people who look at all kinds of things. Like this gentleman here says, well, look how the person rides, you know. And obviously I had other horses I rode, and I had coaches who helped me riding horse correctly and not just pull and crank. But back then we didn't have thermography where people could use with technology like a thermography cameras. And this here, this is our, I love her. She is Dr. Solange Migal. She is a wonderful veterinarian in Sao Paulo, worldwide known. She lectures all over the world. And this group here on my right, these are all veterinarians. And they adopted our Saddle Fit for Life fitting philosophy in their teaching. And you can see here, she has her hand on the horse. You see her hand. And you see all this redness in the shoulder. Okay, so today we have tools where we can look inside the horse, and we have phenomenal possibilities to really look where is the problem and also go further, what happens here. Now back then, veterinarians, if you talk to a veterinarian who's from my age in the late 50s, early 60s, they will say, no, they didn't teach us anything other than maybe give him bute or give him time off, but really we had not anything learned in university, how we're going to treat back problems, or for sure we didn't look at tack. So obviously I was a saddle maker, I was a rider, and I couldn't be the saddle. Needless to say, very sadly, systematically, I unintentionally crippled my horse. And that's why I thought nobody who loves horses should do this to their best friend, as I said, unintentionally. So I teach Saddle Fit for Life all around the world, and I want to help people to prevent hurt horses because people don't know what they don't know. Today we have internet. Today we have many universities, many veterinarians who say, you know, we don't need to hurt them anymore. And besides myself, as a saddle maker, as a rider, and as an author, as well as a lecturer who lectures in many different states around the world, we know now on the horse there are certain points we're trying to avoid. And what happened with my horse, the tree was not fitted correctly from the left to right side. I also noticed that my horse started to have breathing problems. Now we know right here where the saddle sits, the BL13, bladder meridian point 13, or MP13, that area is where we have to really, really watch, because if the saddle put too much pressure on, and one of you other may have seen when the horse is finished riding and there's dry spots, but if the dry spots or the pressure goes on top of that MP13, that is, what does it say here? Respiratory health. That is something when the horse gets pressured, even with the girth down there, but if the horse gets pressure with the saddle up top, that infects his breathing. So all of this, I did not know. Veterinarians did not know this. Now look at this. 2000. When was this research? 2014. That is 7 years ago. But I wrote in the 81. That's when I lost my voice. That's when the damage occurred. And nobody helped me. Sure, I could say I'm a saddle maker. I should know. But if the veterinarians don't know, and the saddle makers in my industry, we haven't been taught anything about shoulder movement. Now we have on YouTube veterinarian who dissect horses and see what damage you do to the shoulder blade. And that's what actually happened. I threw my head on my shoulders. I cried when I saw that the first time at the university in Europe. It says, that has to stop. I saw this horse galloping on the treadmill and the saddle was literally damaging the horse. Today we have computerized saddle pads and we can see when the horse lifts up the leg or the shoulder goes back. So today we know better. Today, no saddle maker should make saddles. No rider should ride on saddles. What hurt the horses and cripples the saddle, sorry, the horse, slowly but surely. So why do I give all these free information away? You know, you would think, well, Jochen Schleser should just sell saddles and make saddles. Why is he educating saddle fitting? Because I think my company, Schleser, has under 1% market share, and that's just North America. With the webinars and these talks, I can reach people from all over the world. I'm always glad to see we have people literally from every continent, and now more and more people even from the Middle East. We see people now, they do care. They understand that the interface between two beings, the human and the horse, the saddle, can make a massive difference to horse and rider. Not only do we have medical doctors who talk about the importance of the importance of the gender-appropriate saddle, but we also have people who are expert breeders who say our horses completely change. Today's sport horse is hyper-flexible, more hyper-mobile, super sensitive, and has longer legs, much shorter backs than the working horse not too long ago. So once I turn to the professionals, people who study horses, such as Sue Dyson, who does the research on the facial expression on the horse, she calls it ethogram, and people who have spent hours and weeks and months and dedicated their life, like these three gentlemen here, they said, you know, Jochen, we are chiropractors, veterinarian professors, and what we want to do is not only do we want to learn ourselves, but we want to help our new veterinarians to understand the equipment is so important. And if a horse has 32 gross plate on the spine, think about that, 32 gross plate on the spine, which not going to close until they're 6 years old. Some of the sport in Western and English, the horse gets ridden before they're 1 year old. It's disgusting, you know, and even if the horse gets started to ride at 3 years old or 4 years old, the gross plates are not done. One of the methods I want really, really everybody to understand, if you really care about your horse and you have a young horse, make sure the saddle fits before he turns six. Make sure that saddle always fits well. You hear the argument, oh, he's not fully developed yet. No, even if the horse is 7 or 8, when you start putting muscles on and the horse gets ridden more and more, the horse will get a bigger thoracic sling, bigger shoulder muscle, and the horse will need to have the saddle adjusted. This is why I do what I do. I know from the bottom of my heart the way I feel about horses. I love horses, but I'm also like all of you are not blind. You see, the majority of the riders are now women, over 80% in English, over 70% in Western. And they love their horse just as much as I do, if not more. And none of them want to hurt them unintentionally. So stop if you're a woman riding in a non-gender appropriate saddle, 9 out of 10 women riding in a male saddle, and stop hurting your horses unintentionally just because somebody said something or was always like this. Listen to the horse. They speak loud and clear. The eyes and ears don't lie. Mary Claire, it's 17:14, which means 5:14. Look at
amazing.
That.
Amazing.
Nine amazing. Minutes. Yes.
You're ahead of the curve. You're ahead of the game by like 1 minute. That's incredible. Wow. Wow. First challenge and you blasted through it. Awesome. Perfect. Thanks, Jochen. Okay. So last week we were discussing what to look for when searching for a used saddle. And I don't think we really got to dive into how much we could talk about with that subject. I think we really just scratched the surface. So I think I'll ask the question again, and then maybe we can kind of delve a little bit deeper. So the question was, how can the average rider know if a used saddle is in good condition?
Right. So the frame of the saddle, the heart of the saddle, and what is very expensive to repair is the interior, the tree. Okay, so when you buy a saddle, okay, what is covered in leather and has foam and wool flocking, the skeleton of the horse and rider is visible here, but the skeleton of the saddle is not visible here. So how do I know that the skeleton of the saddle is okay? And I'm talking about the saddle tree. So there are certain ways you can do, which I'm going to demonstrate quick, how you can test if the tree is okay. But in order to, I want to show you a picture before I turn that off. I want to show you the different types of trees that are out there. Okay, so the old army saddles had big bars. The Western saddles have a little bit less width where the thigh is. And then the English saddle has steel reinforced bars right through here. So I'm gonna blow this up a little bit if I can, let me see. No, of course it doesn't let you do it. There we go. So what you're gonna see here, as soon as I got that arranged, there you go. This is all steel. So this wood tree, they're very inexpensive. This is made out of one piece. The good ones have 16 pieces wood glued and laminated together in the shape. So in order not to break and reinforce it everywhere on the side, everywhere you see it's steel plated. So if you have a wood tree, 99% it's really a steel tree, and that steel tree gives a little bit. So I'm going to switch cameras now, or I'm gonna stop that screen share to share with you a couple things. Okay, where's my first? Here you go. So here is the first. This is all steel. And I can bend this a little bit. And that's why they call that spring tree. Because if I bend it a little bit, okay, so if you apply 180 pounds, that's a lot of pressure. It gives a little bit. But the steel tree, also wood tree, it's not meant to give a lot or to be changed to the horse. So when you have a saddle, you buy your used saddles, you want to make sure there's absolutely no wrinkles in the seat and you don't have any movement between, well, the points from here to here. So I'm gonna demonstrate. So here's the wood tree. There's a little give in it, and it gives a little bit. So that's that wood tree, also steel tree, is not broken. Now I'm gonna put my knees where my hands are and squish that as hard as I can together. And I'm gonna switch the camera for that. Hopefully you guys can see that better. There you go. So right here now, I put my knees between. I gotta get the camera a little bit better position there. So now I'm squishing my knees really, really hard. There should be no give. Okay, so if I force it a lot, This is a relatively inexpensive, cheap wood tree. I could easily break that with my legs. So that's how you test if a saddle is broken. If you go to the, switch cameras again, to another tree, this one here, okay. So many, many companies use a binate tree, adapt tree, or flex tree. These are the more modern saddles. They're not as heavy and they're not as brittle as the steel tree or wood trees. Those are very, very strong materials because you can flex them literally in half, okay? Also in the front. So the material itself never breaks. It's just super stuff. Sometimes for light purpose, it gets weight purpose, it gets cut out pieces, you see here. And also like the wood tree, it has a bracket in front. But the difference with flex tree, adapt tree, or binate tree and DIY trees, all those, they can be adjusted in here because you see the rivets are only attached in the sides, not in the center. So here, there's several different adjustments machine. One machine just make the tree narrow or wide in the angle. Other machines can make the width wider and independent the angle. So that's different tools available. So this tree here has either, you can see here on the side, a short spring steel, and sometimes you can make a longer one or a thicker one, depends how heavy the weight of the rider is. Now, the most important aid is the rider's seat. The rider's seat is the rider's weight. So this saddle here, it's a typical dressage saddle. Let me see what, oopsie, knocking off my light. Yep, looking at the size. So this is a relatively large saddle. It's an 18-inch saddle. So this person here is a flex tree, and this is weighted for a person who weighs around 150 pounds. So you will see on a flex tree, I can easily move this and you will see wrinkles here. Now, when that would be a wood tree, I would say the tree is broken, okay? Because that's not meant to do that. But if it's an adapt tree, flex tree, DIY tree, or binate tree, they're meant to give with the horse's back. And just like the wrinkles on the shoe, they will have wrinkles in the seat if the saddle moves so much. So then again, from the front, same thing. You put them between your legs like that. Squish it very, very hard. And if there's any movement, then that bracket is broken. Another, if this is broken, you can take your hands, easy move your hands apart and it will be broken. Now for a tip, how to look for used saddle for billets. Always look at the billets from the bottom. You want to see any cracks. If bend them slightly, you don't want them to bend. You can see this leather is very, very dry, very hard. Okay, so that's something you can definitely bring back to life. Sometimes if this leather, you bend it and it cracks immediately, then the leather is dead. It means it rottens from the inside out. And then I wouldn't go with this. So this old saddle, just to have a little bit dryness to it, but it's not necessary a wrong or bad shape. This is a typical used saddle. These saddles are very popular because they're very soft in the beginning and because they use very thin leather. So this is just cosmetic repairs. You see the wear and tear. So that is something what I wouldn't be too worried about it. If I buy the saddle used, oh well, that's annoying to ride with this, but it's easy to repair. It's just a big cost to it. This, however, is a bigger repair, and you see this very often when manufacturers put saddles wrong together, or they put the rider, who's a female, rides in a male saddle. You see how this is ripped right there. Now that's a big problem because that's a very expensive repair to do. And the reason why it's broken here, from the wear and tear outside. Either it's bad craftsmanship, or this saddle is made for a male rider. That means when the male seat bone sits inside, you see it sits clearly inside the foam, away from the seam. And then when the rider can pivot on that. But this saddle, as we know, the majority of the riders are women. Here you see a women pelvis, and you see you're sitting on the edge. And that's, of course, exactly where this kind of motion will happen. All right, so very often, not remember what I said in my previous, if you ride in the non-gender appropriate saddle, never mind your back, never mind the horse's damage you do, the saddle is not meant to be roughed and shaved on here. Then I look on the bottom, you know, I want to see if this channel is not too narrow. Sometimes I see stitches here, that's just minor cosmetic. Then I look at billets, you know, the billets here, this is what we call cracked. So be careful on this, because this can last a long time, or it can easily break when you ride. So when you bend it and you see that them crack like that, you'll want to be very careful, because this can go from one day to the next. All of a sudden you have no girth. So these are the main points, what I recommend when you look for a used saddle.
Awesome, thank you, Jochen. And similarly, it's really interesting that there's that damage that you displayed on that saddle right on the seat bone, where the seat bones would be for the female. One of the other questions that I was just going to ask you was, how can an average rider tell that the saddle is made for a man or a female when they're searching for a used saddle, and say, you know, the person who is selling the saddle might not know themselves or might not be able to tell themselves?
Okay, so we have answered that question several times, and I notice it keeps popping up, doesn't it, Mary Claire?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking, let me think for a while. There is maybe a way I can make it really, really clear. So let me rearrange my area again. I'm going to switch cameras one more time for that. And then that, I think, will be super helpful for people to do.
And I'll cut this video up and post it on our YouTube so that people can rewatch it, because it's probably something that, like Shelby was saying also, is, you know, you can hear it a couple times, but it might not sink in.
Yeah.
But the more that people can probably watch it and rewatch it, the more that it'll make sense to them.
Okay. So my first thing is what I would say, get yourself a tape measure. Let's see if I get that right position so you can see. There you go. Good. And what you want to do is measure the middle of the seat. So you lay it down here. So this is 18. 9 is the middle. So what you do then is you look from the side. So you actually crouch all the way down. Make sure your stirrup bar is parallel, because that's how these saddles are made. The bar has to be parallel to the ground. Otherwise, the stirrup leather falls off, or it will never fall off if the stirrup bar is wrongly put on by the tree maker. In my previous discussions, I talked about balance. What is balance? And it starts with the tree. The tree maker will put the stirrup bar on, so it's balanced to the ground. In other words, this is horizontal. So they have a device, and then they mark this tight. That's how this tree, this is balanced. And then the saddle maker uses this as a reference point and balances seat, the flaps, and so on and so forth. Now imagine they would put that stirrup bar on so the stirrup leather can't come off. They angle it wrong. And you fall off, and you have your foot caught. And now you get dragged to death. So obviously that would be a massive liability suit to the tree makers. Imagine they would have this tree that stirrup bar this way. Every time you post-trot, that stirrup leather falls off. So the stirrup bar, it's a great way to start when you want to see, do I have a male or a female saddle? So you look under the stirrup bar, position it on the buck or on the stand, so it's in the middle. Then you crouch down and think, where does the tennis ball roll? And most of the time it rolls to the center. If you can't see the center, that's why I recommend use a tape. So 9 inches. So the pelvis floor, in other words, the area the pelvis of an adult touch is 5 inches average, 5 inches wide. And then the butt goes up this and the crotch goes up in here. So from all the butt casts where people said in the Plaster of Paris, we have over 112 of those. We have seen approximately 4.5 to 5 inches. So this flat spot, the pelvis floor, what you want to do, you go from the middle, 9. Then you put your 2.5 inches forward. 2.5 inches this way, 2.5 inches this way. So that's your 5-inch pelvis floor. That's where the rider would sit. Now, as a saddle maker, we can make the deep spot in the rear. We do this for racing saddles, eventing saddles, or we can make it in the middle. We do it for jumping saddle, for dressage saddles for men, or we do it forward for the equitation saddles or for women. So women's saddle have the deepest point a little bit more forward. So what I do, I put this on and mark this with my chalk. So I have a little chalk here. I don't know if it comes up with the camera. Okay, I picked a crappy chalk. It doesn't chalk up. So now if I would put another level in here or something what rolls, I would probably would have, this chalk doesn't roll very well. But if I would have a pen or something like this, it would roll probably in front of the 9-inch. This means the deepest point is more forward. So that's the first clue. A woman's saddle has the deepest point more forward. The other clue, okay, what you can do once you have determined where the deepest point is, you go 2.5 inches to the front, 2.5 inches to the back, and most of the time it's where the end of the flap is. Typical on the female saddle, that across is 11 inches. Or if you're watching from Europe, that is 29 centimeter. In the front, this seam to that seam, on a lady saddle, it's a minimum of 7.5 centimeter or 11 centimeter. That's how you can tell it's a female saddle. Where's the deepest point? And in the front, is it bigger than 7.5 centimeter? And in the back, is it bigger than, 7.5 centimeter is 3 inches. Or in this case, it's 4.25. So definitely the front seam is pretty wide. Let me show you it this way and let me position the camera a little bit. Hopefully you can see. So now, if I put the lady's pelvis on top, when she sits in this area, she sits, this is a small pelvis, she sits clearly with the seam away from her, so she doesn't want to sit on the seam. Now let's take a male saddle. So here I can identify this is clearly a female saddle. So now let's watch that in the comparison. I'm going to lift this up, look at my stirrup bar first, then I look where does the balance look forward or backwards. So it looks to me that the balance is actually pretty far forward. So it could be a female saddle. Okay, so let's see if I measure it out. I put my ruler, my tape in here. And wouldn't you know, here you go, 9 centimeters. So it's a forward balance. A forward balance means the deepest point is further forward, which women like in general, because a female pelvis has this bone, which is the pubic symphysis, lower to the front when this is level. Okay, so if I compare that to a male pelvis, the male pelvis has the seat bones much lower in the back. This is level, and this here is much higher. So this bone is higher. So in general, the guys like the deepest point in the middle. So just because the deepest point is further forward than the actual middle, I can't immediately assume this is a male, a female saddle. So let's look at this again. I do my same marks, pelvis floor, 5 inches. Or you can go with the back of the flap. All right, so that would be 2.5 inches there. And then I go 2.5 inches forward, that would be here. And then I would measure. And I only come to 9.5. So I'm 1.5 inches too narrow. That explains where the lady sat on that seam and slides over the edge. On the front, I'm 7.5, so I'm okay. So in the front is okay, but the seat width, it's not okay. It's not wide enough for your average female rider. That's a typical get giveaway, that the seat width is too narrow. Sure, you could say, well, some women don't have hips. They're very straight, yeah, but let's have a look where the hips are. The hips are here. We're looking at saddle fitting when we talk about the seat bones. So this is a very often a misunderstanding or misinformation from saddle fitters. They talk about, oh, that lady is so narrow. Look at how narrow her hips is. That hips is made out of your femur with your femur neck and where your hip sockets are, not where your seat bones are. All ladies have a birth channel. So of course I can't say all ladies need 11 inches, but if you want to know if it's a male or female saddle, that's the way you identify it. This year, what I call is a half male, half female. Very often you see manufacturer do it, so they can sell one model to both sexes. So I think that's the same thing if Levi's would make a pair of jeans. The right leg is for the right side for the jeans is for the female, and the left jeans is for the male. Nobody would ever buy these jeans, but yet in the saddle industry, people do this all the time. And that's why we see so many saddles damaged here, or so many saddles don't fit the horse, because so many people struggle with the fit to the rider. Mary Claire, do you think that was a little bit more helpful with the measurements versus?
That was definitely a lot more clear. Can I just get you to answer one of my questions? So as a rule of thumb, is there any kind of seat width that you could say, or kind of measurements that they would want to be looking for as a rule of thumb? You said 11 inches typically? Oh, okay. Okay. Awesome. Thanks, Jochen. And for everyone who's tuning in, thank you for watching and thank you for commenting where you're from. We have some viewers from Australia and Alaska who have been commenting. And again, if you have any other questions, any other saddle fitting questions, feel free to drop them in the comments and we'll get to them either today or next week. For those of you who are tuning in also, we have a saddle giveaway that is running up until the end of the year. So if you have not yet heard and have not yet applied, definitely check it out. I will link it in the chat box below. And you'll definitely want to go and check that out and share it with your friends as well, because it's a great opportunity to win a beautiful Schlaese saddle of your choice. So check that out. And so we'll move on quickly to our next question. So this one comes from a lady named Lisa, and she says, what are the top 3 things to look for? Oh, that's kind of similar to what we did earlier when buying a new saddle. Is that kind of... That's probably a little bit too similar to our previous question, right, Jochen?
Yeah, let me answer it.
Okay.
First of all, the number one, what you want to look for it, look, if you're a male, if it's a male saddle, for me, for a female, obviously, if it's a female saddle. So make sure you get the gender appropriate saddle first, because one of the things, just alone the difference, guys always have more space between the upper thighs than the ladies. And we want a saddle tree for the ladies. You can't measure that, but you need to ask when you buy it. See the rails here? They can be sometimes really wide for females. And when you sit in the saddle, what's made for a man by a man, for some Olympian men, then you don't have to wonder why you get such a hip pains, because your neck of your femur and your hip sockets, they will be pulled apart. And of course, your lower back pain and your knee pain and foot pain comes through the sciatic nerve pain, what gets pinched on the upper inner thigh. So make sure you get the gender appropriate saddle. Here again, 11 inches from seat to seat bone on the female, on the male, average less than 9 inches.
Okay, so that would be the top.
Number one,
okay.
Okay, so number two wants to be, you want to stay off the horse's spine. Saddles do shift, go from left to right due to many various differences of a saddle. I mean, there's tons of reasons, but you want to make sure that the saddle stays off the spine so you don't have to go surgery. That comes when you ride really shitty, pull and crank, or you sit in the wrong render appropriate saddle. Eventually the horse will get a sway back, but it starts off very, very slow, you know, and you, the statistics says themselves, why, if kissing spine is a disease, but why do we only see 3% on horses who are driving horses are kissing spine? Kissing spine means when all these bones glue and calcify together, but not just on top, also on the bottom here, what you cannot surgical help with, where the holes, where the nerves comes out, okay? When they get smaller and smaller, it gets pinched nerves, okay? So that is something you cannot fix. So number two, turn your saddle over. It should always sit on top of the ribs, away from the spine. If you buy a saddle, always make sure it has a minimum of your entire hand. This saddle has only 2.5, maybe 3 finger space. That can only fit a very, very, very narrow thoroughbred. And even a very, very narrow thoroughbred, you can see here the spine. Of course, this horse has spinal damage, but this width here alone is 4 fingers. And that's a narrow horse. So make sure when you get number two, buying a saddle, make sure it's nice and wide. Of course, check the tree, like I explained in the beginning of our talk. And what you want to make sure is that ask the person, hey, can I change that saddle in the tree width and in the tree angle? Okay, if they say no, I have no clue what you're talking about. The horse's shoulders, this is the growth stage of the horse, okay? Or if you train them from basic to Grand Prix or from 1 year, from 3 years to 8 years, you know, that's the tree width. The shoulders, it's back where the metal plate sits. That's the angle, the tree angle. So you want to ask your person you buy it for, is the saddle adjustable in the tree width and in the tree angle independently?
Okay. Awesome. Thanks, Jochen. Sorry, I was muted. perfect. So that really breaks it down for you guys who are, I guess a lot of people are shopping for used saddles and constantly wanting to know these types of things. So it's yeah, great. For sure. Thank you. Appreciate your answers. And coincidentally, my last question was about kissing spine as well. And so this person asks, is poor saddle fitting the leading cause of kissing spine? And how does poor saddle fit cause this?
Okay. The reason why I say yes, because I like to say there is a reason why only 3% kissing spine disease, it only exists on driving horses. 45% of Western horses have kissing spine and hang on, I get my math wrong. Yeah, 80% of English horses, double as much as Western, have kissing spine.
Wow.
So if it's only a disease, then you got to ask yourself, what does an English rider who has a lighter saddle, who has an average lighter rider, why do more English horses have kissing spine? That is from a leading veterinarian in Albany, New York, was Schenectady, who was also so nice to wrote a chapter in my book. She was telling it to me. Her name is Carol Visha, Dr. Carol Visha. You know, if we have these stats, then I would like to say, yes, kissing spine definitely, definitely is a problem from saddle fitting. Look at this. This is the dust pattern of a saddle. Look how that saddle twisted and shifted. You know, so we see saddles which are too long. Here's a dust pattern of a saddle too long. And here's a saddle that's perfect. Nice wide spine, away from the ring of lights. It's not too long. How many saddles do you have out there, Mary Claire, where you can turn it upside down and put a man's fist in between the stuffed panels? Very few. And on Western saddles, all Western trees, they have the fleece and the sheepskin go there, but the bars are 4 inches wide. How many Western English saddles can you do it? Very, very little. Very little. Okay, so this is a bad picture. Let me find a better one. The disaster of the majority of the English saddles are too narrow. This is okay, but look how that saddle shifted. And that's why I totally believe the kissing spine. Here's it comes from bad saddle fitting or increases this. The spinal nerves come out here, the multifidus, who you cannot pinch and squeeze because that gives the spine the strength. We have a saddle fitting checking system like the Port Lewis system. And when you ride, you can see with an English saddle, the pressure's here and here, barely anything in the middle. So we have high pressure front and back, kind of like you're laying on your stomach and somebody takes a chair and put it on your back. That's kind of what they feel. So for me, yeah, definitely it's caused by bad saddles or bareback saddles, treeless saddles, because the withers here, when they fall back and you don't have a tree, what you have treeless saddles, they put so much pressure on the spine, it's insane. And we cannot not believe with a second that the largest skin, the largest organ, the skin, what hangs from the withers, when you sit directly on it, because saddles what are too narrow, or saddles what sold, bareback pads what sold as saddles, the saddle has to go. Here's another good example. Look how narrow that saddle is. Horrible.
Mm-hmm. When you mentioned earlier, you said you called it a disease, or it's referred to as a disease. How does that kind of come into play with, it's believed, it's understood, you understand it to be caused by this, right? But how can it be referred to as a disease?
Because a horse what has never been ridden could have kissing spine.
Okay.
You know, and some horses have that defect. Mm-hmm. Right? But if a horse gets ridden and there's weight on the horse's back and you do not lift the horse's back up, in other words, consciously, properly ride so that through the proper riding, the horse is elevating the back. And if you don't do that, well, here we go. Here's a good example. You see how all these bones are very close. So when you ride and the horse brings the back up, see how they're all spaced out? Okay. So when you ride shitty, crank and pull, right? Or if you have saddles what sit on the spine, then of course they go hollow and then they rub, and nature has the way of gluing that together.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you. So we have one last question for today, and that's also one that I've heard before, but it's a great one. So this person says, "I'm a woman and I've always ridden in a saddle made for a man, but I haven't really noticed any issues with pain. But how can I tell if it's actually causing any damage?"
Okay, so for me, I made so many sales before I actually talked to a gentleman who is, well, a doctor, and he showed me the difference between male and female and explained to me, just like horses, human could have huge problems, especially in the lumbar. I had no idea how many riders have been operating on L4, L5. In nature, we are not meant to ride or walk like that. You see a lot of riders, either they're bobbling with their head or they have this round curvature and they learn somehow to manage. We have a great self-defense in our body. Before it really hurts, we're going to tighten up. And the Spanish riding school says it the nicest. They says if a rider has a cramped seat, they will never have a pliable seat. A pliable seat is only available if you have your shoulder, hips, and heels in one line, sitting on the horse while the sternum and the ball of the foot, sternum of the horse, ball of the foot, sternum is all in line one. Then you can have your four shock absorption and you can pivot. Now, if you always have ridden in a male saddle, you're still going to do whatever you do without you even knowing to stay on the horse and your body conforms with that. So a good example is if you have walked forever in too tight shoes and as a young kid, you play soccer, you go dancing, you do football, basketball, but you have too tight shoes, your foot deforms. One day it will start. When you have compensated, that disc in L4, L5 will slowly but surely go to the back. Okay, and then when this starts slipping, then the pain comes. Right now, the muscles hold that contraction. This is how it's been explained to me. We as riders, as humans, need to make sure we always have a good posture and make sure that the top of each vertebrae is horizontal. If I ride bareback, treeless, or in the gender non-appropriate saddle, I compensate by protecting my crotch and my top of my vertebrae, it's not horizontal. So I know I have to sit up. I'm going to put my shoulders back because if I have a structure what has a complete different tailbone, here's the male, here's the female, and the saddle is made to avoid this hard bone, and you need the support here, you got to use your back muscle, not your abdominal muscle, to support that. Okay, so this woman here who, I don't know if it's this picture, who rides in the, let me forward that.
Daily exercise on horseback enabled ride stick muscle.
There you go. Let me just play this. Muscles.
But this is done exclusively by using the important basic riding aid is a prerequisite for generating a harmonious flow of movement between human and horse. Many riders wrongly try to tilt the pelvic ring by activating the back muscles, but this is done exclusively by using the abdominal muscles, or to put it more exactly, using the muscles of the forward abdominal wall. The erector spinae, the back stretching muscle, plays the role of the corresponding antagonistic muscle. Importance not to cause the pupil any discomfort. With a cramped posture, it is impossible to achieve a pliable seat. Without a pliable seat, it is not possible to achieve oscillation in a horse's back. And if its back cannot oscillate, the horse will suffer pain and it will not be able to collect.
So this was from a DVD from Vienna, the Spanish riding school. And let's have a look. As a guy has longer tailbone, straighter lower back, the butt cheeks are closer to the horse's back. you have a solid seat and the tree, the saddle, gets built around this. As a lady, your average body, you have more lordosis, and all of you ladies have a short tailbone, and your gluteus maximus, therefore, sits higher. So the space where my mouse is here, okay, you need to have to support that. If you don't have it, you either grip with your thighs or you'll be a cramped rider like the video just said. If you're not cramped and you're not riding on a planet called the moon, where no gravity is, gravity rules on the planet Earth, you will sit down. Okay, you either cramp with your thigh to keep that natural posture to keep the pliable seat, or you fall down. And when you fall down, well, that's what I was saying earlier, then your upper body, sorry, your disc is not level, you compensate and the disc will slip. And you might not have pain now, but eventually, just like walking around in too tight shoes, eventually the bunion will be an issue. You will have a displacement in your foot and your knee and your hip goes. This is just the way it's been explained to me by a medical doctor, because I rather would make just all the saddle the same, like I was taught from my master. And having male and female saddle, I thought, oh my God, now I got to make two different type of saddles. Or I can listen to a medical doctor by the name of Dr. James Worsen, who says, if you don't want to deform or hurt the body long-term on the rider, and you want to help the horse, you've got to start with the proper fitting, proper gender appropriate saddle. So if it doesn't hurt yet, it's just a matter of time. These are the words from professionals who've been to medical school, which I haven't. And it makes sense for me as a rider, and it makes sense as common sense for me as a human. Eventually, the body will complain.
Right. And I'm sure it affects the weight distribution, like you just explained, for the horse. So I'm sure the horse will also be the one to suffer. So it's not even just a concern for yourself and your own body, but for your horse. Yeah.
That's why I played that little video. I didn't know if it came across on live stream. Sometimes it's lagging a little bit.
No, I could hear it perfectly.
Oh, good.
Yeah, that was great. Thanks, Jochen. And thank you, everybody, for tuning in for another session. These are always so special and we get to learn so much. And for everyone who, you know, if you have any kind of question or anything that you would like us to tackle next week, feel free to either contact me throughout the week or drop it on our in the chat box right now, or send it to us on our social media, and we'd be happy to answer your questions, because this is why we're doing this, right? Is to help educate people and share this knowledge so that less riders and less horses have to go through this type of pain. And we can just empower each other with knowledge. So thank you, Jochen, for spending the time with us. We really value your time and really appreciate this. So thank you so much.
My pleasure. See you next week.
See you next week. Bye.